in your tree.
The Santa Cruz mission was likely the first enterprise to create significant impacts to Coho in the river. With its use of the all-important cold karst springs for domestic drinking water, use of the alluvial riparian zones for grazing, and water of the mainstem San Lorenzo for irrigation, this was likely the first ongoing significant impact to Coho. Early mission days, which were characterized by a paucity of food and subsequent drought years, where crops failed and Coho would have been easily harvested from the lower river, also were likely the first large-scale negative anthropogenic impacts on the San Lorenzo Coho. The powder mill dam, which moved upstream from the location of the original paper mill dam in 1862, presents passage problems to migrating salmonids even to the current day. Passage at this site is limited to flows estimated to be above 70 to 100 CFS. During some dry years, these flows may only happen one or two times. Given the rigid life cycle of Coho, that may mean that a given year class may never get to spawning habitat in the upper San Lorenzo watershed. Just upstream of the paper and later powder mill dams is another barrier that is a legacy of the industrialization of the watershed in the late 1800s. A popular fishing and swimming destination, Four Rock, as it's known by the locals, was created by falling blast rock and failed sections of rail grade just below the Inspiration Point reach of the Santa Cruz and Felton Railroads, now Roaring Camp Railroad. While not a total barrier currently, it likely was and continues to be a formidable migration barrier to the relatively unathletic Coho salmon, especially during drought years when there may be only one or two storms which would provide passage through this site to upstream spawning habitat. The barrier has existed likely since the construction of the rail grade in late 1874, and certainly since the successive failures of the tunnels and rail grade during the period from 1874 to 1907. The rail grade still sends debris flows of rock and mud into the river to this day during wet winters. Considering that this period is characterized by several successive drought years, as well as serious floods, which would have either prevented Coho from rearing in the streams or scoured out their red so that they unsuccessfully spawned, not only would one year class be impacted, but all 3 year classes of Coho may have been seriously reduced by these barriers alone.
The San Lorenzo, after we took the fish down, then by that time we had all the lime kilns cooking and a lot of the lumber mills going, and all the bark and everything was being dumped and sawdust being dumped in the river. And there was that period, that one article I found, the Sentinel, the County Board of Supervisors declared the San Lorenzo dead in, what, the 1890s.
Coho were absent just from driving removed this key component. And as you know, large woody debris provides geomorphic stability and habitat complexity. And Santa Cruz County, out of all the counties I've worked in, does the worst job of protecting its large woody debris. And so that's reason number one. Reason number two, I think, is the incredibly high road density. You have over in the watershed over 8 miles of road per square mile. We consider 3 miles of road per square mile to be bad. So you couple that with these roads being old, poorly maintained, and located on weak soils and inner gorges, this is the source of immense chronic and episodic sedimentation. And as you know, high sediment loads result in high turbidity, result in smothering of spawning gravels, and buries those important pools that Coho need. And reason number three I'm going to throw out there is the urbanization that is throughout the watershed. This is resulting in changes in riparian vegetation. You have people that use the river as a swimming pool in the terms of summer dams. At one point, you had over 40 summer dams on the river. I'm always dealing with spills. Your county is dealing with high nitrate levels from failing septic, although it's not as bad as it used to be. And then just this high degree of urban interface results in constant channel modification from buildings being located on stream banks and other efforts that they engage in to protect their poorly sited properties. And so that's a chronic ongoing thing, and you don't see in watersheds where Coho still persists the high degree of urbanization